Gautam, admittedly, he himself admits he has a mysterious title. So I won't tell you what's in the talk, although I know. Gautam.
So thank you. Hear me, yeah. So this, what exactly I mean by the wisdom of crowding will become clear as I go along. What I want to discuss is work done essentially in close collaboration. Can you hear me? So, with an experimentalist, Sandhya Kaushika at the TIFR in Mumbai. And her lab uses genetics, imaging, molecular methods, etc., to study molecular mechanisms that regulate cargo transport in neurons. What we add, coming from a theory point of view, is modeling, simulations theory, and a somewhat different perspective on these problems. So there's a disclaimer. This really isn't, there's not much information processing in this talk, but there is robustness. And these are sort of two sides of the same coin, in a sense, because you can't have, you need, what you need is robust information processing, not just information processing. So that's crowding in an Indian context. So when we think about crowding, we sort of think of pictures like this, with lots and lots of people assembled in a fairly small volume. But biological environments usually are also very crowded with many different types of molecules. That's just a picture from David Goodsell of all the different types and shapes of molecules in some small region of the cell. Crowding in general is assumed to be, in quotes, bad. That's because physical barriers to normal cellular processes are involved in crowding. Rates of reactions are altered because of nonspecific binding to various reactants. And making the connection between what is in vivo and what is in vitro becomes more complex if you account for this large mass of other types of molecules, all of which can be doing pretty much passive things, nevertheless influencing the active processes, the other useful processes that happen in cells. But then this leads to the question of, are there contexts where the inevitability of crowding mandates some robust cellular solution? I'll be fairly pedagogical in the first part of this talk because there are many students here. So just to remind you, cells come in many shapes and sizes, and we'll be interested in the cells here, which are nerve cells, which are characterized by a cell body and a long axon. And we'll be interested in transport along this axon. So neurons, which are those nerve cells, transfer information, which is essentially as a combination of an electrical and a chemical signal. So the action potential, which is the electrical signal part, propagates at some velocity along here, between here and here, and leads to a process that happens at this point, at the synapse, where this nerve cell contacts other nerve cells. The chemical signal is essentially in little bags called vesicles. So these are neurotransmitters typically that are encapsulated in vesicles. These are presynaptic, meaning that they happen before the synapse. And these vesicle bags we can call cargo in a very general sense. So now the question is, how do cargo vesicles get from here, where all of this stuff is made, to this point, which can be very, very far away? So there are essentially two major ways of moving things within a cell. The first is undirected, purely diffusive motion, which doesn't single out a particular direction. And the second is processive or directed motion. Diffusion is good at short scales, bad at long scales. And essentially, this inefficiency is because essentially here, you go, the region you sample goes linearly with the time. The region you sample here goes as the square root of time. So the cell solves the problem of moving stuff over large distances through molecular motors. And these are little molecular machines. So the scale here is roughly about 80 nanometers between this point and this point. This is a motor, a kinesin motor that moves on a microtubule shown here. So these are tracks. So motors move on tracks consuming ATP. So these are driven processes because they're essentially sustained by a non-equilibrium concentration of ATP within the cell. The other word for this is a prototypical example of active matter at the scale essentially of a single molecule. And all of this internal driving happens because there are non-equilibrium biochemical reactions within the cell that help to maintain ATP and ADP in relative concentrations that are not given by the thermal equilibrium requirement. So why molecular motors are crucial for transport is just this. Again, with diffusion, you don't get anywhere very fast. But with motors, you can actually move fast from one point to the other point, provided you're targeted in the right direction. So here is a movie of axonal transport, just to sort of illustrate some of the points that. So that little creature here, this is from the Hugenrad lab. It's called A Day in the Life of Motor Protein. And this illustrates many things that I will use as an example as I go along. So this is the protein in front, holding on to the vesicle, moving bravely onwards. But there are other proteins also stuck to the vesicle. And this guy here is asleep, sort of hanging on here. And you should think of this as a cartoon visualization of another cartoon, which is a cartoon of how stuff moves along in the axon, essentially moving through this little motor here. So this is called John for some mysterious reason, but it's moving along here. And this is where it starts, and this is how it moves. And you can see all of these microtubules. This is the microtubule on which it moves, but it can sort of be directed in one direction or the other as it moves along. So again, to sort of proceed with this movie a little bit, you can see this brave little fellow walking ahead. And at some point, this other motor can latch on to different things. For example, I think this will now hold on to this. And now you have a tug of war between the motor in front and the motor at the back that's trying to move. And at some point, one guy wins. I think the guy at the back finally, his hold slips, and then the motor in front takes over and moves ahead. And the other motor at the back, which has been passive so far, can now suddenly wake up, grab on, try to move in the opposite direction. And again, now you really have a tug of war situation with the two motors moving back and forth. So all of these are pictures, they're idealizations of different types of physical models that people have used to think about the situation. What you need to take away from here is that the cargo is usually much larger than the motor that actually transports it. So what we want to do is the following. For the case of axonal transport in a particular model system, although what I will tell you is actually fairly general across different model systems, we want to ask a question. How does the cell deal with the problem of efficiently transporting material in a crowded environment? The material here is presynaptic vesicles. What we would like to do as biophysicists is to try and understand, are there any general principles that may be helpful in understanding what intracellular transport in crowded environments has to surmount and how it does that? So C. elegans has its connectome is precisely mapped out, the synapses, the neurons. It's a very good genetic model. It's transparent. So these experiments can be done on live organisms that have been anesthetized so that they don't move around when you image them. And these experiments also look at the touch neuron, the particular type of neuron that's sensitive to touch of the worm. The numbers for the human brain are, of course, 86 billion neurons and 100 trillion synapses. So this is very, very much smaller, but tractable. It's a useful genetic system, and you can actually visualize it. The touch neuron is filled with microtubules. So there are many, many tracks. So this is just a cross-section through here. And each of these little circles is a microtubule. And the scale of the microtubule is, I guess, about 20 nanometers or something in size. And you can see that if, given what I told you about the size of the cargo with respect to the size of the microtubule, there really isn't much space, especially in the central region. So it's known here that much of the transport is actually peripheral. It happens on the outside. There's lots of stuff that anything being transported through here, this is a cross-section, has to contend with. So here are the microtubules, and here is one big obstacle, which is the mitochondrion in red. So anything that must move from this point and encounters a mitochondrion must find a way to get across it. So as I said, this is transported from, so here is the cell body, here is the Golgi. And stuff is being moved from here to here. There's other stuff coming back from here. This is the long axon. And the motors, most of the motors are known in this case. It's UNC104, kinesin 3, kinesin 1, dynein, et cetera, et cetera. So as I said, what's important to the scale of motor plus cargo to the separation between the microtubules, and this implies the transport really happens on the outside and not so much in the bulk. So the way the experiments are done is that adapter proteins that connect the motor to the cargo are labeled fluorescently, and this is what the actual data look like. It's just a movie of little bright spots moving along. So now the question becomes, how do you make sense of data that actually looks like this? And that's really all that you get from the experiment. And you have to take this, abstract this into a theoretical model, figure out what are the sort of constraints that something moving in an environment like this must face, and then try and back out from that some general intuition for what might be going on. Here's a sort of, again, an illustration of how the motor moves with one head going sequentially above the other head as it moves along. So the basic technique of dealing with such movies is the following. It's called a chymograph. So since you know where the individual bright spots are, and you know where they are as you take a 5 frames per second camera, or even better camera, you take multiple shots, and then you attempt to connect these positions up between each frame. So something that was here at this time has now moved here at this time and has now moved forward one more step at this time and then has moved backward. This one here has pretty much stayed exactly where it was. So because they're fluorescently tagged, you know where they are. You can connect these lines up in order to form what are called chymographs. So the straight line here indicates that the vesicle doesn't move. Lines are drawn downward. This is the time direction. And these connect essentially the positions of individual vesicles. So this is a space-time diagram. This is called the chymograph, which essentially is these connected space-time trajectories of vesicles. This is an experimental picture, and this is the sort of picture that we generate using simulations, where we can, because in simulations we can do whatever we want, we can color each individual vesicle a different color. And you can see that by and large there are similarities between these, and I'll explain how these are obtained. But for the time being, note the following, that in both here and here, there are large stretches where essentially you have straight lines. This means that vesicles aren't moving between this time here, for example, and this time here. So the word is chymograph, depicting space-time trajectories of vesicles. And in typical chymographs that are generated from experiments, there are vesicles that move, for example, this trajectory here, this trajectory here, this trajectory here. And there are vesicles that are stationary. Okay. So having seen that, you must infer the properties of cargo vesicle transport essentially from pictures like this, just space-time trajectories. What do such chymographs actually tell us? So the first thing that sort of strikes you if you look at a lot of these chymographs is that far from everything pretty much moving, there's a lot of stuff that's actually stalled. It's not moving at all. And this is stationary cargo, and there are lots of clusters of stationary cargo. For example, here there's a cluster, here there's a cluster, here there's a cluster. In between, this vesicle has stopped here and then moves again, stops, moves again, etc. And the observation of stationary cargo in chymographs of vesicle transport in neurons, in axons, has been seen for a long time. But it's been largely ignored. And the reason is that it's more interesting to study stuff that is actually moving, there are motors involved. It's not very clear why stuff is stopped, why stuff is stalled. There could be, you could think of many explanations for this. And for, it's essentially because of the complexity of this problem that people haven't really looked at this issue, and preferring to look at, study very intensively the case where things are moving. Yeah. The full movies are typically between 1 and 5 minutes. So this is probably something like 30 seconds to a minute of movie. So here is the question. You have to deliver cargo from or to the synapse. Isn't it just inefficient for it to stop? Why is there so much stalled cargo, and what is holding it up? The second question is, given that there is stalled cargo, and that if you're moving, you must inevitably encounter stuff that is stuck on the way on your path as you move, how does it affect the motion of moving cargo? How do they interact? How does moving cargo interact with stationary cargo? And finally, the interesting biological question is, what is the functional significance of all of this? Okay. So in these, typically, you don't see much diffusive motion of the cargo, mainly because this environment is an extremely tight environment. So when we stay stationary, we mean things that are basically straight lines in the chymograph. We don't know whether they're attached or unattached. That's very hard to say. We assume they're attached for reasons that I will describe in the model later on. But you can't really tell the difference. It's possible that they're just staying there and there's no motor attached at that particular point. Too small and too difficult. Because all of this you have to sort of contend with the difficulties of understanding and analyzing fluorescence images when they come too close. So, those are experiments that are actually impossible to do. Whether the motor is actually attached or not, it's hard to tell. Okay, so let me just go through some of the experimental data. I will summarize all of this in detail, but I don't want to spend too long on the experiments because they're detailed and other people have done them, not me.
Bundles, right? So I mean, the thing could be stuck on the other side. So it need not impede traffic.
So in fluorescence, these are narrow enough that you can't distinguish which side of the microtubule. So they could be stuck on the other side or not on this side. That's fine. Count all of that together. Okay. So first of all, I said stationary cargo covered a significant fraction of the axon. So the numbers are around 30%, 31%, et cetera, in this particular experiment. And between 1 minute and 5 minutes, this is the number of long-lived stationary clusters across the 10-micron region. So this is a good number to remember. Between about 20 to 30% of stuff is actually stuck. So when I say stuck, I mean in a xenoparadox sort of sense, everything is stuck if you look at a small enough time. So you first must put a cutoff to ensure that the normal sort of stuckiness, if there is such a word, of vesicles, you look at times much larger than that if you want to define a cluster. The cutoff we take is about 5 times the normal pause time of vesicles. So here is the distribution of lifetimes. You can look at clusters that survive between 15 and 30 seconds, 30 to 45 seconds, et cetera, et cetera. what you should look at is these very long-lived clusters. So this is survive for more than 1.25 minutes, more than 5 minutes, etc. So this is all of the stuff that is essentially stuck throughout the time that your chymograph has been taken. This is largely independent of cargo type. So there's a whole lot of biology that goes into looking at multiple cargo, multiple organisms to try and say that this is a general phenomenon. It isn't particular to the touch neurons, ALM or PLM of C. elegans, but it's seen in Drosophila, for example, as well as in cultured neurons. So what other cellular components do such stationary cargo correlate to? I said they stopped, but do the locations of their stopping correlate to any other thing inside the cell? If a cluster begins to move, is it more likely for another moving vesicle or vesicles to stop at the same point? Yeah. Yeah.
You actually see occasionally stationary cargo.
You do, absolutely. So I'll show you some examples of that. Interestingly, yes. And first of all, clusters, you can sort of do dual color imaging of microtubule ends and cargo, of actin and cargo. So they correlate to the presence of microtubule ends. And they also correlate to actin accumulations along the axon. They also correlate, interestingly, to the presence of, as I said, mitochondria, which are these large, slow-moving creatures that move along the axon. So there are these three different things that they seem to correlate to. Here's another interesting point. I remember that I raised this question of what happens when you have moving cargo that comes and intersects with stationary cargo. What happens there? Their motion happens to be modulated. Some cargo appears to pass through. Some seem to get stuck. Some go backward. So reversals are very prominent at stationary clusters. So here's a summary of the experiment. And since I didn't describe the experimental data in any great detail, I didn't even really comment on the picture that I showed you. This is what you really need to know to understand what I will describe a little later. Stationary cargo seemed to be fairly generic to axonal transport across multiple systems. Around 20 to 30% of the cargo is stationary at a given time, given a minimum cutoff time. There's a broad distribution of lifetimes. There is cargo that is stationary for short periods of time, 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 25 seconds, a minute. And there is cargo that remains stationary for up to 5 minutes, which is as long as the typical movie takes. The locations where cargo becomes stationary correlate to where actin accumulates, as well as microtubule ends. They also correlate to other stuff that is bigger and moves more slowly, such as mitochondria. And finally, and importantly, these stationary clusters modulate the motion of vesicles that move across them. Yeah. So that's a good question. Beyond a certain resolution, you can't make out whether it's diffusive or stationary. And in certain mutants, you see much more diffusive motion. That is a lot more back and forth. These tend to be mutants where you break up the microtubule much more, the MEK7 mutant. Elegant. But in general, you see very little diffusive motion. If it's stuck there, it's sort of, it looks as though it's pretty much stuck there. OK. So there are two broad points of view that you can take. And the first is a more conservative one. You can say that, look, stationary clusters of vesicle cargo are completely uninteresting. If you try to move anything in a crowded environment, you will bump up against other things. They may be moving slowly. They may be well attached. So this is really a boring question, and you shouldn't be studying it. The second interpretation, which is certainly not conservative, is that these clusters mark regions where you control vesicle motion. And the properties of clusters are modified in disease and aging and by stimulation. And clusters have regulatory and functional significance. In disease, for example, in certain types of neurodegenerative disease, you see a large clustering of vesicles. They basically seem to be clustered together. And these blocks are significant in altering the nature of axonal transport. So certainly, in those extreme cases, you do see that clusters are important. And how exactly you get to a state where you have these dynamical clusters that come, form, et cetera, to disease situations like this is still a very open question. So which of these, is it this or is it this, which is the correct view? So now? We don't know, and we're not saying anything about it at the moment because we really don't know. Just to point out that existence of large clusters is also a feature of pathologies in neurodegenerative disease. So in general, clustering of these axonal of vesicles appears to be enhanced, controlled, modified, et cetera, in disease-like situation, which is one reason why one should think about clustering. OK, so now I'll describe the model that we've been working on. This is a model that centers around the cargo and pretty much ignores the motor. And for this reason, it's very different from the normal models that people write down that take motors very seriously and assign all sorts of complicated mechanics to the motor themselves. There are many reasons for this. The first reason is that we actually know very little about how many motors are bound, how they compete, whether they compete or whether they cooperate. Mechanical models for such motors are complex, messy, and they're not particularly useful in the context that we want to look at. It's far better to start from the experiments and think phenomenologically about those experiments and what they might be suggesting. So this is where this approach deviates a lot from other ways of thinking about how motors transport cargo. Okay, so in the next few slides, I'll go on to describe different parts of our model. As I said, multiple motors bind to vesicles because you have stuff moving both forward and backward. Motor transport is bidirectional. But it's pretty likely that only a few of them are engaged at any particular time, just from considerations of how big the vesicle is, how it's coated, how far, how big the motor is, how many motors you can fit on the surface, etc. An essential part of stuff getting in other things' way is that there is some steric hindrance, or what we call exclusion, between them. So here's an example of one vesicle here with motors attached to it, another vesicle here with motors attached to it. And these really can't get closer than this distance that separates these centers here, because then these additional parts of this will, these additional motors that are stuck, will start to interfere with each other. And even the fact that this is a cargo, which is a physical object, which cannot be, which you cannot superimpose another physical object on, will ensure that these are kept a certain distance away. So let's, for the ease of thinking about it, subdivide the whole complexity of the axon into different compartments. So this is one compartment here. This could be a dead end. This is a junctional compartment. And here might be the synapse. And we'll study essentially this, although now we've sort of built up to putting these assembles, these assemblies of compartments together to try and understand transport across the whole axon. So think of a single compartment and ask what happens at these edges. Here you have retrograde vesicles leaving. Here you have antrograde vesicles coming in, sorry, leaving here and leaving here. You have antrograde is in this direction, that is from the cell body towards the synapse. Retrograde is in the reverse direction from the synapse towards the cell body. And how do they move? This is, the microtubule is really one of the few situations where a lattice model in biology is completely appropriate, because motor binding sites are separated by a fixed distance, in this case 8 nanometers. The vesicle moves a lattice step at the time, and from, this is we know from single molecule experiments on the kinesin motor involved, and they extrude each other on the same microtubule. So when I say microtubule, I could also be saying protofilament that is separated. I'm sort of going to conflate these two terms together. I'm just going to assume there are a bunch of sites along across which these are all arranged in parallel that define the outer ring of these microtubules. As I said, transport is peripheral to the bundle. And I'm going to say vesicles extrude each other on the same microtubule, provided they're close together. If vesicles are moving on different tracks, they just sort of pass by each other very easily. And this is also known because there are many situations where you see in the chymographs some bright spot coming here, some bright spot coming here, and they just sort of pass through without even noticing each other. So the interpretation there is that they're not on the same or nearby microtubules. They're somewhere on some microtubule that's too far for them to directly influence each other. If you have oppositely directed vesicles on the same track, again, purely from physical reasons, they will bump into each other. They can collide and block each other from moving. So this guy cannot move unless this guy moves out, and vice versa for this. You can even have collisions between two vesicles that are going in the same direction, simply because this might halt for a while and allow this to catch up. And then unless this moves forward, this can't move forward again. So what happens when you're blocked? So this is the situation where I had one vesicle moving in this direction, one moving in this direction. You can unblock this by allowing this to move to a parallel track. And this happens because the head, the two heads of the motor can be fairly widely spread apart. They can span the distance between adjacent protofilaments. So this is one thing that could happen, just surely by Brownian exploration of the environment. The other thing that can happen, potentially, is that a blocked vesicle can change state. So this vesicle here, that was initially had a motor attached to it that wanted it to move in this direction, can suddenly change the motor that was attached to it and decide to move in this direction. So, you know, you might ask, is all of this imagination and have I just made this up? And the answer is no, because from the chymographs and specific examinations of vesicle trajectories that come and encounter each other, you can figure out, you know, what happens when something comes here and the same vesicle goes back in this direction. So that's how you track what's moving where, is stuff colliding, is stuff just passing through, etc. So this, all of this requires some level of guessing about the experiment and what it might be saying, because these are experiments that are hard to, these are questions that are hard to address by experimental means. So there is some amount of intuition involved in figuring out what is the right model for these. Yeah, sorry. I'll show you the model. In the model, it's a cylindrical sort of ring of microtubules that we have.
Hi, Gautam. You also said that you assumed a step of 8 nanometers based on the idea that a single motor kind of like it working. But wouldn't you also argue, I mean, maybe you're going to talk about this, what happens when vesicle size themselves change, because then you would imagine more than one motor.
In principle, I guess that's possible, that you have one motor here, and then when you sort of move forward, the next motor takes over. That's
large, in which case they're almost...
Or it could be large. So it turns out that the scale of the vesicles here is not very large. It's about 30 to 40 nanometers. So it's not very large. It's not like 80 to 90 nanometers.
Between microtubules in the axon, how does that relate to the size of the cargo? I mean, is the packing of microtubules itself?
No, I understand. I get the question. So we're not. I'm not going to be very careful about that, because this whole question of should I worry about individual protofilaments on the same microtubule, or should I worry about a protofilament here, a protofilament here, a protofilament here? These become a little more hairy questions to deal with, because we know very little about what, at the molecular scale, what can the motor do? How far can it move backward and forward? So the model that I will describe is somewhat agnostic with respect to this, but these are certainly important questions that at the moment we have no answer for. So it's this combination of sidestepping and changing of state that must be at the root of how vesicles can move past each other. Particularly, there is very little evidence for diffusion being important. And this is an important point, because there are models for motors and stuff attached to them that say motors can move along, then fall out, then move along again, then fall out, move along again, and then fall out. But this is this very special situation where you're so tightly bound, and your environment is so tightly held together by the fact this is a very narrow axon, that that just doesn't seem to happen. Or even if it happens, it doesn't happen much that we need to worry about it. Okay, so more complexity. The track on which these cargo vesicles walk is not a perfect track. There are breaks in them, so something coming here will not find a place to move as it goes forward. As I said, there's other stuff that can be on the track. Just the one example was the big mitochondrion that I showed you in the EM visualization. So any of these cargo-bearing motors that comes here is unable to move forward. The only thing it can do is sort of sidestep around until it finds a feed track to move across. So here is a physical picture that I'd like you to think about, which I hope I've tried to motivate so far. Here is the cell body. Here is the axon. The axon is made of a bunch of tracks. The tracks are complex because they have breaks in them. They carry cargo that moves both forward and backward. And there are big blocks inside here that can prevent stuff from moving. So this is, in a sense, captures the whole complexity and the messiness of the real experimental system. We don't know, but we don't think so. I mean, again, that's somewhat, maybe you can do that in single molecule experiments, where you can actually put it on a track and see how far is it deviating, but in these you can't tell. So it's assumed that these are pretty much moving along on single track without switching between tracks, unless they're held up by something. Okay, so what I will tell you a little bit about, having told you about the model, I'll tell you about simulation. These are kinetic Monte Carlo. There are many parameters that we take from experiments. So as I said, this is phenomenological. So we don't want to have complicated, 20 numbers that describe motors and springs and catch bonds and attachments and diffusion constants. We will look only at what the experiment suggests, take numbers from there as much as we can, make guesses for numbers that we don't know, put them all into finally a simulation that is of this sort. So wherever possible, we need to benchmark between the experiments and the simulations. Okay, so first of all, here is the chymograph, here is the simulation. You can ask, how many types of motion are there? For example, you could have motion that is very smooth and walking along here, between here. And so those would be these straight lines across here. You could have stuff moving forward. You could have stuff moving backward. And you could have stuff that sort of moves, stop, and go. It moves a little bit, then it stops for a while, then it moves a little bit, then it stops for a while. So it turns out that if you stare at these long enough, you can figure out that there are three major types of motion. This isn't excluding sort of even more complex varieties of motion, but there are at least three. So the first is called smooth anterograde. So that's the straight line, long straight line segments that you see here in this particular chyme graph, as well as here at that point. There is staggered or step anterograde, which is move, stop, move, stop, move, stop, move, stop, etc. And there is smooth retrograde, which is in the other direction. And you can find, you can look at these chyme graphs and find examples away from clusters of these different types of motion. If you ask what is the ratio of different motion types, it turns out that this seems to be fairly tightly controlled in the C. elegans touch neurons. There's about 50% of stuff is smooth anterograde, 10% is staggered, and 40% is retrograde. So there's a slight excess of forward motion with respect to backward motion. So this is in regions away from clusters where vesicles are moving. If you sort of categorize those moving vesicles, it turns out that the ratio is this amount. The speed is about the same, yeah. So the typical speeds are, but motors move at about micron per minute. Vesicles move at about micron per, motors move at a micron per second. That's numbers that are related to the ones we have here. There is no staggered retrograde in these particular, in this particular cell type, but you see it in certain mutants. Okay, sorry, I went through that too fast. Let me just do that again. So this is no sidestepping or changing state. Yeah.
Sorry, just to be clear, when you go back, when you say the ratios 50, 10, 40, you're weighting by the blackness as well, right? So you
don't look at the blackness. You look at stuff that is only moving.
So you
exclude the cluster.
If I take a staggered anterograde line, there's one there that I see that looks like it's sort of quite darker than some of the others, and I might assume that that's more than one vesicle. It's a little cluster moving along, and so that's why I'm asking whether the 50-10-40 is weighted according to
the brightness of the line.
Exactly.
No, it isn't. It just measures. You're right. It's possible that there could be one big vesicle moving, yeah, or maybe two moving in tandem together. In which case, you might look for them splitting out at some point.
Comment. It has the molecule that has been tagged is GFP-RAP3. So it's a membrane-bound protein. So just by looking at the brightness, it's difficult to tell whether it's one vesicle or many vesicles.
Also, once they move, then the signal becomes lighter for sort of various optics reasons. So even the variation in the intensity also distinguishes between stuff that is stuck and stuff that is moving. Okay, so here is the first simulation, an example of where you have no sidestepping or changing state. So because you have motion that is bidirectional, you can sort of quickly realize that nothing will actually go anywhere very fast. Every guy who's trying to go in this direction will meet someone who's trying to go in the opposite direction. Let's wait for the state to become blocked. So this is no sidestepping, no changing state. There's one little guy here who's still moving around. And then what we will do is allow for sidestepping. Sorry, we have to wait a bit till he gets to his. So now things begin to move around. So sidestepping is one way of relaxing these sort of jammed configurations. What's interesting is what happens if you wait for a longer time. So this is the same movie. It's just run for a little longer. So pay attention to this little cluster there. So this is periodic boundary condition, so stuff comes back. Now you can see stuff is stuck. It's not obvious that that just allowing for sidestepping would have automatically led to stuck configuration. You can prove that configurations like this are, once you get into them, you can never get out of them. It's harder to prove that these are natural endpoints of this transport dynamics. Yeah.
Yeah, so with periodic boundary conditions, when somebody leaves one track, he has to start again on the same track.
Exactly.
So
it's less surprising that this should happen.
So if you had something where you're sort of randomly injecting them at one end, do you end up in the same?
In some cases, yes. In some cases, we just haven't waited long enough for that to happen. So we feel it'll happen, but we haven't actually tested that. So you need to allow changes of state to get out of these stuck configurations. But these changes of state, as in the experiments, are only operative when you block vesicles. So in here, you can see sort of stuff moving. Stuff will get stuck here. Then this will begin to move. All of these clusters, they will live for a while, and then they will break up again. So this is three colors for three different types of vesicles. You can see clusters that form for a short while and then break up, clusters that are long-lived, for example, the clusters here. And then you can do even more complicated things. You can put in the ends of microtubules. You can put in a mitochondrion. So the mitochondrion sits here, and this is the part that's expanded out. And now you can see that these ends of microtubules tend to have these little cluster-like objects. There are some that don't. There are some that do. And this particularly large mitochondrion block that spans a number of these filaments is a particularly good attractor for vesicles to come there. OK, so that was a simulation model. And we can change the parameters, do whatever we want, introduce many, many more breaks in the microtubule, put in diffusion if we wanted to. At what level does it reproduce the microscopic dynamics that you see in the chymograph? And the answer is it does reasonably well. For example, pretty much most stuff that you see in the chymograph has some replicate somewhere in the simulation chymograph. So you see the formation, stuff that is moving here, briefly stationary, and then moving apart again. These crossovers where things come from here and here and then form a stationary cluster. Being a simulation, you can do anything that you want to. You can do different numbers of vesicles, so 50 vesicles, 100 vesicles, 200 vesicles. So just to tell you, what we do is we simulate 10 protofilaments in a ring. These have 1,000 sites each, so it's actually 10,000 sites. It's across these 10,000 sites that we distribute 50, 100, or 200 vesicles. So you can see that for small numbers of vesicles, this is a perfect track. So you have some amount of noise, but this is just sort of random stochastic noise even when you average. If you average long enough, these will go away and become smooth. And this is the case where you have the mitochondrion as well as the microtubule breaks. So this is the density, the time average density in terms of vesicles per site. And this is location between the first and the terminal point. You can see that around these locations, you have a peak in density. And around the mitochondrion, you have a larger peak in density here. And this is all with different rates between here and here, just to illustrate a point. You can look at currents and how they vary. How are currents affected by having microtubule breaks and mitochondria, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What happens? You can look at the current separately for each different type of vesicle. And you can sort of find your way around this, your large phase space in this model carefully enough. So have a look at this. This is now going back to the simulations and asking questions about clusters. So if you have no microtubule breaks or mitochondria, you have a relatively fast decaying. So this is normalized to the experiments. Fast decaying distribution of stationary clusters. So there's a large number that survive between 0.25 and 0.5, a smaller number between 0.5 and 0.75, an even smaller number. Nothing really that survives out to this. But you put in the microtubule breaks and you put in the mitochondrion, you have this peak remaining there, but then you have this peak picking up here. And it's a strong function of the density. At large densities of about 200 vesicles, you have a big peak here, and yet an even a somewhat smaller peak for even the 100 or the 50 vesicle problems here, which you didn't have in this. You can look at interconversion rates and show that currents and long-lived clusters are sensitive to these rates at which vesicles interconvert. And you can also look at the correlation between the clusters and the standard blocks, the correlation between clusters and microtubule ends, between clusters and mitochondria. We can do many things, and we have done many things. So I just want to show you one example, which is bleach recovery. And there was a nice movie, which unfortunately isn't playing. We can also do exotomy, which is where you laser section a part of the axon and then sort of see how density piles up on each side. You can look at the properties of individual vesicle trajectories. So this is bleaching. So here is between here and here, you're not bleaching. At this point, you bleach all of the fluorescent labels. So this region becomes completely white. And then you look at the recovery of this region as vesicles begin to move in. And you can do this for 50 vesicles, 100 vesicles, and 200 vesicles. And by the time you get here, you can see these fairly large regions where vesicles are stuck. And then what you can do is to look at the recovery of the density. So this is at the point where you bleached. So it's completely white here, and the blue is the density on the other side. And this is how the density picks up as you move forward in time as a function of the different densities. So this is something that you could compare two experiments and just, again, benchmarking the problem a little better. So here are the main observations from the simulations, that only sidestepping is insufficient to produce unblocking. You must allow vesicles to change their state. The changes in state happen from the experiments and as incorporated into the simulation only when vesicles are stalled. Where are they stalled? They're stalled most prominently at clusters of other vesicles, where vesicles are most crowded. And you typically never have a situation where you change a state somewhere in the middle, where something that is coming here just reflects backward. So our own thinking about this problem has evolved over the several years that we've been studying it. So our sort of bottom line was that crowding may play a special regulatory role in ensuring smooth transport by promoting changes of vesicle state in dense regions. And what we've shown is that you can get these from multiple sources, microtubule ends, acne accumulations, et cetera, et cetera. So now the question is, what is crowding what? Are vesicles crowding other vesicles, or are vesicles being crowded by all of this other stuff that is there? So that's the subtlety. Is it vesicles crowding other vesicles, or other stuff crowding vesicles? It seems to be more important to all of this other stuff, seems to be more important than other vesicles, and this really surprised us. It would have been a very attractive solution to say that, look, crowding is when vesicles sense the presence of other vesicles, and this is how the cell deals with crowding. Well, it is crowding, but it's crowding not of an obvious sort. It's crowding of by stuff that is not a vesicle, but by other things. The way you do this is that you look at regions where single vesicles encounter actin patches or microtubule ends, but other vesicles are not present. And essentially, the changes of state that you see there are the same as that you'd see when you encounter regions where vesicles are rich. So what we think now is all of these effects contribute. They're all together. It's not as though any one of them can be neglected. But it's the ends of the microtubule that are really dominant. There's some evidence that both motors and actin patches tend to cluster there at these ends of microtubules. Here is one idea for what might be happening. This is the picture that we started with, which is vesicles with coated with motors that were moving along. But there are also free motors. So that's this little thing here, this thing here, this thing here, this thing here. And free motors can also attach to microtubules, and they can also move along. And in principle, they could also cluster at these ends of microtubules. So one could now ask, are microtubule ends regions where motors are A, present at high density, and B, can hop on and off easily to stalled vesicles? There are some technical problems with being completely unambiguous about this. Mostly these problems are problems in imaging, of labeling three things, the microtubule ends, the cargo that is being carried, as well as other types of stuff that you might want to label. Okay, so I finished much earlier than I thought I would, but that's lots of time for questions. So the first conclusion is stationary clusters are important. They've been neglected through something like 20 years of people studying this problem. But as far as we can see, as far as our idea is, that they crucially modulate the properties of vesicle motion by allowing for the change of vesicle types, allowing stuff that is moving forward to move backward. And this is the root of how you can avoid permanent traffic jams inside the cell, provided diffusion is not allowed to you. Diffusion is always a way of getting out of a traffic jam. You just jump up in the air and then you land somewhere else. But in these axons, because of this very tight constraint on space available, that doesn't seem to be an important way of relaxing density accumulation. So here's another idea that is kind of pretty. And that's the idea of the depot. The idea here is that stationary clusters may function as storage points for vesicles. They may hold vesicles for a while, because we now know that there's a long distribution of time scales over which vesicles are stuck at these depots, at these stationary clusters. And this is points to a positive role for crowding in the following sense. The cartoons that I showed you had a cell body, a short axon, and something at the end of it. But actually, there is a huge distinction in the length of the axon versus the size of the cell body. You can have, the axon can be much, 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 much larger than any other linear length scale associated with the cell body. This places very central constraints on the time that it takes to move from here to the point where you might need some signal molecule or some something stuff that is required at the synapse. So the idea behind the depot is that you don't need to go all the way back to the cell body if you require something. All you need to do is find the vesicle that is stored at the nearest depot or the one next to that. So instead of traversing, instead of something needing to be sent all the way from here to here to here, you can imagine that these clusters are storing, dynamically holding, storing, holding, storing, holding, storing vesicles across locations all the way between here and here. That is a very different idea for what these clusters might be doing. Okay, so I have actually shown you no equations at all. I have only shown you simulations. And as a sort of card-carrying statistical physicist, biophysicist, I feel I should at least tell you, at least in words, of where this links up with theory. So So these are multi-lane, multi-species, bidirectional extrusion processes, and sort of plug for some work that we did. The connection between motor transport and extrusion processes was actually in a paper written a long while ago, although we don't get enough credit for it, but this essentially outlined what the connection was and how it could be used. The question of how to do mean field theory in a case where you have these external sort of blocks. If you had a purely uniform track and nothing distinguished any spatial point from another, you could do a mean field theory. It's just a little more complicated here. There is something called, in quotes, a standard model, which is a sort of bidirectional model. It allows, it sort of looks at entities moving along in this direction, but they can move to the left or the right if they're blocked, and they can also move across each other. So this is a bidirectional model. And this model was proposed by Zia and Schmidtman, and Madan wrote down a model that is actually fairly similar to this. Again, this seems to be an interesting direction to look at if one wanted to come up with something analytic for this model, except that if you really wanted to deal with the complexity of the multiple vesicle types, the breaks and microtubules, et cetera, that becomes technically much more complicated. We sort of have ideas of doing some queuing theory for cluster sizes and lifetimes. This philosophy of ignoring motors altogether, just looking at vesicles and phenomenologically at what vesicles do, is interesting, but I think biologists especially would like to have more of a concrete feeling for what the motor is doing. That seems to be one direction in which one could go. At least you try and understand, why do we have smooth, staggered, and retrograde? What determines the transition rates between these? Can we understand that by having a slightly better understanding of what the motor is doing? And at the back of it all, what we really need is better image analysis coupled to statistical analysis and the simulations. And the image analysis is actually crucial. As you can see, it's very hard to look at those chymograph trajectories, these fairly faint lines there. And you know, you can have a graduate student sort of looking at these in detail, drawing lines, but we would like to automate this process a little bit. So people talk about crowding, and here's a nice sentence that the constituent elements of these systems have evolved to function optimally under normal physiological, crowded, and or confined conditions. So these conditions are natural to the biological system, and somewhere along the line, evolution must have figured out a way to deal with them. And so we suggest that thinking about crowding, the role of stationary clusters in relaxing these potentially and these large accumulations is important. And certainly we'd like to see more work along those lines. I'm a fan of this book, and I particularly like this. I think it's come from your preface. It says, and because I teach both in a physics and a sort of biophysics group, I'm particularly sensitive to this problem that it's easy to teach physics in very standard ways. There are standard textbooks, and some of them, especially if you're teaching classical mechanics or electromagnetic theory, haven't changed for the last 80 years or 70 years. But the whole field of biophysics is far more diverse, and I like this last sentence. None of this is necessarily good or bad, but it can be confusing for students. And to present to students the variety and the vigor and the excitement of this field in a way that, you know, is a sort of in a self-sustaining way is a challenge for people who teach this. Okay, so this work is done largely with Sandhya Kaushika, and a bunch of students and postdocs have been involved. Kausalya did the initial experiments. They were continued by Parul at TIFR. Vinod Kumar and I have been doing the simulations for this particular problem. We've been working on this for a long while, and at some point we were supported by NUS in Singapore and a bunch of other support from our own institutions. So thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer questions.
Hard to do experimentally, but if you sort of bloat up an axon in your simulation, then space out the microtubules and reduce the number of vesicles, do you see a change in transport? So you argued for a positive role for crowding. I'm saying if you, in your simulation, make the environment less crowded, do you see some problems?
That's an interesting question. So I'll give you a slightly different answer. This question of, is there regulation at these clusters, can be addressed in the following way. You take the anesthetized worm, sort of lies on a slide, and then you tickle it with a hair, and the worm sort of goes into some convulsions, and you sort of ask what happens to the clusters. It turns out that the clusters sort of suddenly seem to dissolve, with a sort of fluorescence of vesicles coming out of there. And presumably, this mechanical stimulation has done something to dissolve or change the configuration of the clusters that existed before that. and suggests that clusters are actually fairly pliable and can change what they're doing, their accumulation, their structure, the way they move around. And this, we believe, is important. I mean, I don't know if that's really the answer, but that's one answer to what one can do to look at clusters, change their densities, etc.
So maybe you mentioned it, but how sharp is the, when you talked about the formation of the sort of these big blocked regions, how sharp is that transition in density? And the reason I ask is because, you know, in a very abstract sense, you can imagine it's a bit like a sort of dynamical percolation theory where in one dimension that goes around the axon,
yeah,
or the microtubules, in the sense that once you've covered every protofilament, there's no way to sidestep past. And so you might expect a sort of sharp appearance of critical light phenomena.
So the sharp transition where they all collapse onto one of those rings that I showed
you? Yes, exactly, yeah. So you show that as a function of density, I believe, and you showed the appearance of this extra bar on a sort of bar.
No, in that I just that was 200 vesicles, a movie run for a long time, in which I didn't allow vesicles to change state. I allowed them to step by each other, but I didn't allow them to change state. And as Bill pointed out, this is a periodic boundary condition, so the vesicle that comes out here is coming back again here. But the answer to that is, if you look at the models, the last few models that I described, the model by Zia and Schmidtmann on the standard model, which is kind of like this, it's a simplified version of this. You have stuff that's moving in both directions, and when something moving here encounters something moving here, then it sort of passes through with some low probability. Those models, you can show that there is a transition between a freely moving state and a stuck state. Now, there's some subtleties that are mathematical associated with that. It turns out that the stuck state is not truly stuck, but it survives for 10 to the 70 or something like that time step. So in practice, it's always stuck. But there is evidence, at least that was a paper that raised this evidence for a transition between the stuck and the unstuck phases.
So in this case, diffusion may not be responsible for movement, but at least changing state of the vesicles, can it be attributed to diffusion locally?
It's possible, because we don't know, and that can't be resolved. Is a vesicle just sort of, once a vesicle comes up against something that it's stuck, either an accumulation of actin or an end or another vesicle, maybe just transiently lifts off, right, reorients, and then another motor can come and attach. And maybe that's the underlying microscopic interpretation of what we summarize in just a rate for changing states.
So then
we don't know that yet.
Okay, so in your simulations, how do you importantly change the phases, the states?
So there is a rate in which if a vesicle is stuck, if it cannot move forward, then with some probability it changes the state into one of these other states.
So what is
those rates are chosen so as to maintain the 50-40, 50-10-40
ratio. Okay.
So there is some constraint on that. Okay. Again, those numbers are somewhat hard to fix. But that there is that particular constraint.
Yeah. So can the vesicles coalesce with each other, like oligomerize? Can they do that?
In principle, they could, and this is again sort of a worry that we had. Maybe that's what is happening, and we don't account for that in the simulations, and it's not something that we can prove at the moment.
I mean, that's another mode of generating clusters, right? No.
Sure,
yeah.
That's true. That would be another way. We don't. I'm just wondering how one would.
So.
I guess in principle, you could have something moving here, track exactly. It here, then it forms a single thing stuck, and then that whole object moves together.
Yes, yes.
That seems to happen less. What happens is that you have vesicle coming here, stopping together, and then both of them moving apart. Mm-hmm. We don't know whether some material could have been exchanged when during the time that they're in contact, and that's a possibility. In fact, that was our earlier idea, that whenever you have vesicles jammed up against each other, mm-hmm. it's easy for a motor to hop from this membrane to that membrane. And maybe it's this transfer of motors due to physical contact that gives rise to this change of state. But it's hard to say. Again, that would be a guess.
Okay. The other question I had is about the microtubule ends. So what are the boundary conditions you impose there?
So overall, there's periodic boundary conditions. So it's a ring that sort of comes back like this.
That's
but
right.
Where we break it, we break it here, and then we leave a bunch of sites unoccupied. So once it comes here, it cannot move forward. It has to sidestep.
Okay.
It can choose to sidestep or it can change state. Both are possible. Because both these processes are sensitive only to the fact that you're blocked.
But you cannot move or hop off the...
In these simulations, no. That would be. It turns out that in one particular mutant that has many microtubule ends, you do see much more diffusion. You see much more motion that's bidirectional. And there we think it is important. It seems to be somewhat constrained to a local region. You don't see sort of large diffusive motions in many. It's still somewhat confined, but much less so than in the other case.
Okay.
So just for my mathematical curiosity, I mean, so what exactly is proven and what exactly is simulation? So for which kinds of models do you actually know the stationary distribution? And you can, for example, these questions about the clusters and when they appear. I mean, then you wouldn't have to do everything.
So the simplest model, which is the model of vesicles only moving in one direction, is pretty much known and beaten to death. And that's a sort of difficult calculation involving Vete-Ansatz techniques. There are some versions of the bidirectional transport that are known. I don't know what is exactly known versus what is mean field theory and so on. This particular model in which you had bidirectional motion and some probability for vesicles to pass each other if they came in contact, that is that the fact of this transition not actually being a transition, just a huge crossover, that's also established very clearly mathematically. But any model with the complexity of the sort that I've described here, with multiple states, and especially breaks or irregularities in the tracks, and pretty much nothing is known about that at the exact level.
Are the synapses, not synapses, the motors and the vesicles, are they by any bit, do you think, are electrically active or electrically sensitive, rather? The rationale I ask is, if they were not, then your Depot hypothesis, how do you plan to go about doing that? If it's a long Depot which stores out stuff, only when there's some electrical activity do you need to release
it. It could be calcium, for example.
So it's
and we don't know. That's, again, things that we're actually looking at. What might be the signals? The idea behind the Depot is that you don't want to go all the way back to the cell body to get stuff. But if you have a way of storing it in between and releasing it on demand, that would be nice.
So the on-demand part is where I'm asking it should be sensitive to some sort of a stimuli.
That's right. So calcium was certainly one thing that we could hypothesize. We know that the clusters are able to release because from this tickling experiment, you do see that clusters that are stable can become destabilized when you excite the worm. And so there is obviously something is there that is sensitive and able to respond in this generic Depot sense. But the mechanism of that is something we have no understanding of.
I want to ask the last question. Oh, Bill.
So you made the comment that since you're hard-carrying statistical physicist, you had to show us a few things. One thing you never showed us was something like a correlation function. So I look at these things and you say, well, you know, I can see this branch here and I can see that branch there. Is there some way of summarizing the statistical properties of these trajectories, both from the data and from the models, so that we could compare them as opposed to, you know, looking at two things and saying they look alike?
There certainly is. The only problem is, A, whether a biologist can measure it, which maybe they can because it's probably encoded there in the chymograph. But the slightly more interesting question related to yours is this. We know that there is targeting. We know that vesicles that are made at the cell body have to reach the synapse. We know the stuff that is recycling stuff from the synapse has to move back. This model didn't really have that. It had stuff moving and it could suddenly decide to go back and then decide to go forward. You can tweak the rules of the model so that you remember that if you are sort of initially tagged as an antrograde vesicle, you remember that you're tagged and then you keep moving in that direction whenever you can. You can still maintain the 50-10-40 ratio while doing that because there is some amount of flexibility in the choice of those rates. There we have been looking at these correlations functions that you described. If you're already moving in this direction where you're destined to move, how to what extent do you retain that memory of the destination as you move along in time? So that's extremely good. The spatial correlations, we've looked at questions of how many vesicles are stuck at a cluster. Experiments say between 2 and 3 or 4. For us, it depends upon the density. So again, that's one way of benchmarking the density in our simulation. We think the density is probably, for these numbers, somewhere between 50 and 100. It's probably not as high as 200. Most of the simulation that I showed you had 200 vesicles over this large region. But that's again a tricky issue to understand because that number fluctuates too as you have stuff coming in from the cell body. We have been looking at correlation functions in the sense to try and understand where does this memory come from and can we use that to suggest to experimental data analysis how to figure out this memory. This seems to be a very tricky and little understood issue in this field.
Okay. In fact, that was my question. Does stuff actually get from one side of the cell to the other in this model?
So the trajectories, you have some trajectories that seem to sort of move pretty much where they want to go. You have trajectories that move backward and forward a lot. So that would be one suggestion to do experimentally, that this is kind of surprising, that if you look at a vesicle that's initially moving antrograde, between this point and this point, how many reversals does it actually undergo? And the prediction from these models is that it should undergo a fair number of reversals. And the other prediction is if the memory of that state is retained, then the statistical properties of these trajectories should be reflected or should reflect that memory. That is still at the stage, we're not at an experimental stage where those questions can be answered.
So you mentioned that in diseased states, you have more stationary clusters. Is that some kind of stress response, or you think the neurons have lost the ability to dissolve stationary clusters?
I actually just said that to pique everybody's interest, but I'm not very sure that clusters in the sense that we're thinking about them have anything directly to do with that. But you could argue that since having large clusters is bad for transport, maybe normal cells have ways to deal with clusters, dissolving them before they get too large. And it's that particular, those mechanisms break down in disease states. This is a different way of thinking about this problem from other ways. We sort of assume there's some protein aggregation that holds things up and so on. So it's just in the sense of being a different way of thinking about that problem of aggregation and later disease than conventional ways.
Okay, well, that was the sign for coffee. So let's thank Gautam again. And we're back here at 4, I think.